Hello, I guess. Hello, everybody. This is my first online seminar, and I would like to thank the organizers for this opportunity. It's nice to see so many old friends that even though we are home, well, we can still talk to each other and enjoy doing mathematics. Okay, so my talk is about free boundaries. Let me apologize, I'm not an expert in free boundaries, but this is what this is what I did. And okay, I work more on conformal geometry, and okay, the word conformal is in the talk, but okay, we'll see if we arrive there. Now we stick to free boundaries. Okay. So let me say that my talk will have two parts. The first one is on the Steklov version for the composite membrane problem. And this is joint work with Kiam Lee and Taehoon Lee. Taehoon Lee is a student of Kiam in Korea, and we are finishing a paper now. I think it's going to be in archive in the next few days. Now, in the second and shorter talk is some work in progress joined with Marielle Saez, and we are working on higher order versions of the Steklov eigenvalue. Okay, so before I start with the talk, let me give you a quick review about the Steklov eigenvalue. So let me start with omega, a smooth domain in Rn. And omega is going to be to have boundary, let me always call it sigma. And I'm going to consider the following boundary eigenvalue problem. So inside, I take Laplacian u equals zero, and I put the eigenvalue problem at the Neumann condition. So normal derivative of u equals lambda u on my boundary sigma. Okay, let lambda one be the first non-zero eigenvalue. And this eigenvalue is called Steklov. And it has its importance in applications, etc. I don't want to get into that. Let me just recall that the Steklov eigenvalue can be calculated as through the Rayleigh quotient, just upstairs, that is the gradient u square, the Dirichlet energy, and downstairs, what I have is that the L2 norm of u, but integrated over the boundary sigma. That will give you the boundary eigenvalue problem. And of course, you have to ask that the integral of u is zero. Okay, so now I can set up my free boundary problem for the fractional, for the Steklov eigenvalue, and you will see that this will become a half-Laplacian, or more generally a fractional Laplacian. This is the first part of the talk. Okay. So the motivation comes from the well-known composite membrane problem, and which is saying that so to build a membrane in omega with varying densities, such that it has prescribed mass and frequency as small as possible. This is the standard composite membrane problem. There are some works by Chanilo and collaborators, and after all, it becomes a free boundary problem. Now, when instead of to consider this problem, you take the mass to the boundary, so you arrive to the Steklov version. So let me set up the problem is to build a membrane in omega with varying density rho, but the density now is concentrated at the boundary sigma. Now, we are asking that it has prescribed mass and frequency as small as possible. Okay, more precisely, we have to find a density rho, okay, let's say bounded between two constants, and the integral of rho over the boundary equals to m, the total mass that is fixed from the beginning. And we also need to find the function, to find the eigenfunction u, such that the integral of rho equals zero. And now we want that this pair realizes this double infimum. So the infimum in u of the energy, because the Rayleigh quotient gives you the eigenvalue, and then you take the infimum over all densities, rho. Okay, so what is this? We are taking the Steklov eigenvalue problem that I posed before, and for every density, and then we are minimizing this eigenvalue over all densities, and this is our problem. Okay, so now it can be proved, and this I will mention it later, by the bathtub principle, that there exists an optimal configuration and the density rho only takes two values in sigma. So for instance, so the extremal values, it takes the little h in D and big H in the complementary, and this is the best you can do. Now, between D and its complement in the boundary, we get a free boundary. So this is a free boundary problem, but on the boundary. Oh, too many boundaries. A boundary, free boundary problem, maybe? Okay. So now I'm going to change a little bit of the notation, a little bit this notation, and instead of working with little h and big H, I'm going to change the constants, and I'm going to set, okay, forget about the density, we set u and d our unknowns, and consider the following eigenvalue problem. You can see that the previous, the composite membrane that I, problem that I posed translates into the following problem here. So inside the domain, you still ask that Laplace of u equals zero, but now the Neumann condition, normal derivative of u, you need to add plus alpha, and alpha is a constant that is related with the h before, with the data from before, the characteristic functions of the set d times u equals lambda u on sigma. Now, d is our unknown. D is any measurable subset of the boundary. Oh, sorry. It's the boundary of omega. That is a typo here. Now alpha greater than zero is fixed. And we denote by lambda D for its domain, we calculate the first eigenvalue of this problem. And we define capital lambda of little a to be the infimum of this first eigenvalue among all the measurable subsets D that have fixed measure little a. So now I'm not going to say anything else about this equivalent problem, but I'm going to forget about the original composite membrane problem. And this is the one I'm going to consider in the next slide. So this is our problem, given alpha and a, solve this and minimize. And the minimizer is going to my unknowns, u, d, are going to be my optimal configuration. Okay, so well, how does this relate to the fractional Laplacian? Okay, you are seeing here that I have a normal derivative of u and you are harmonic inside. Okay, this is like the extension problem for the half-Laplacian. Let me rewrite this problem for all the fractional Laplacians. That's easy, but a quick review on the fractional Laplacian. On Rn, it's a pseudo-differential operator with principal symbol c to the 2s. Okay, this is well known. Let me just go quickly through this review. You can also write it as a singular integral where the fractional Laplacian is calculated as the convolution with this singular kernel with a principal value. And from here, you see that you need to know the values in Rn, so it's a non-local operator. But what is more important for us is the extension problem to the upper half space. So now let me set up omega to be Rn plus 1 plus, that it's the points x and y, that x is in the original Rn and y is positive. Now for s, for power s between 0 and 1, that's the ones I'm going to consider those powers. Consider the following extension problem. Take a divergence equation in the extended space in x and y with this singular or degenerate weight y to the 1 minus 2s that has a Dirichlet condition given by little u on the boundary that is y equals 0. Then the fractional Laplacian of little u is calculated as the Neumann derivative of my extended function big u with the weight. Okay, So with this, if there is no weight, you see that you recover the normal derivative here, and it seems natural to study the fractional version of the composite membrane problem. And I'm going to put some Dirichlet conditions just to not to worry about the ends. Okay, so for a given S between sin 1 and alpha positive, consider the following eigenvalue problem is sigma contained in a ring. Now, I'm going to put the Dirichlet condition equals to 0 on the complementary of sigma, just not to worry about it. For me, now sigma plays the role of the boundary. And consider the and take the following problem, the free boundary problem, minus Laplace SU plus alpha characteristic function of the U equals lambda U. And okay, this is the generalization with what I told you before, because before we had here the normal derivative of U, I mean, just changed by any fractional power of the Laplacian. I mean, there is not much difference. So this seems to be a reasonable generalization of the composite membrane problem that I posed before. Now D, as before, is any measurable subset. We denote by lambda D the first eigenvalue, and define capital lambda, the infimum of this first eigenvalue among all domains with prefix measure. And okay, takes the same amount of work to do all the powers of S, so let's do it this way. And what did we prove? So our first theorem, or our first result, is that given these constants, one can prove that there exists an optimal configuration UD. And moreover, U is C to S if S not equal to 1/2, this is not completely right. U is not C0 to 1 if S equals 1/2. This should be erased and just write that U is C gamma for any gamma between 0 and 1, but you don't arrive to Lipschitz. Now, if you see, this is the optimal regularity of the optimal configuration. And while S is not equal to 1/2, it's quite very sharp. The fact that for S equals to 1/2, you don't arrive to C0, C1, it's going to give you some headache. So even though the results are going to be true for S equals to 1/2, in the proofs, I'm going to I'm not going to tell you what happens in this case because it's more technical, more involved. Okay. So the main theorem here is that we need to fix S in between 0 and 1/2. 1/2 is included, but more technical. Now, let UD be the optimal configuration. Then one can prove, this is the main result of this paper, is that D is a sublevel set of U. This is D can be written as the set where U is less or equal than T for some T. And that, okay, T is chosen so that the D has the right measure A. So this is what we prove, existence of the optimal configuration and actually characterization of the optimal configuration as sublevel sets. Now, while existence and regularity is more or less, I mean, okay, you have to work, but you can do it. This to show that exactly this sublevel set was the hardest part. Okay, let me go through the proof of this result. So now you start, and remember that I mentioned the bathtub lemma before. So it's used again. What is this bathtub lemma tells you is that your set D is contained, it's not a sublevel set, but almost. And where is this lemma coming from? Just take the book of analysis of Leaf and Laws, and it's there. So there is, this is something that your undergraduate students can do. The hard part to prove the theorem is that the set where U equals T exactly has measure zero. And why is this more difficult in the non-local case? Okay, what happens in the local case? In the local case, you have this equation. Now, if the set where U equals to T, where U is constant, has not measure zero, so it has an open neighborhood in it, then the Laplacian is zero because your function is constant. So then you quickly get a contradiction with the numbers here, because that, so that's it. You have to do nothing in the local case. But in the non-local case, even if there are two difficulties, and the difficulty I mentioned is that a function that is locally constant near a point may not be have zero fractional derivative. So you cannot run the same argument as the same easy argument as in the local case. And this is where all the, I mean, where the heart of the proof is, how to overcome this, this fact. Now, another difficulty is that you don't know in advance the regularity of the free boundary partial D. Now, this is an open problem. We have some guess, but we'll deal, I mean, we didn't do it in this work. So it's still open. Okay, so what did we do for the proof here? Okay, we need to show that this set has measured zero. So we look at the unit continuation arguments for the fractional Laplacian from Fall and Feli, and we try to do, we use some ideas from there. So the idea is that you use, the idea is to use blow up limits. But okay, when we use blow up limits, we have to prove regularity and convergence. And it turns out that we are able to rewrite our problem as a two-phase unstable obstacle problem. So okay, if you know how to do that for in the fractional case, then you get regularity for blow up limits for this problem, oh, fractional. Then once that your blow up limit exists, I mean that your limit exists, you have to show that it's non-trivial. So you need a non-degeneracy result, and we borrow the ideas from Caffarelli, Roque, Joffre, and Sir to show non-degeneracy, and then you will get a contradiction. Let me elaborate a little bit more on these arguments. But as I mentioned before, we will restrict for simplicity to the S less than one half case. So otherwise you get worse regularity and the paper gets more technical. Okay, so what's the idea of the blow up limits? Okay, there is some rewriting to do done here. I change my variable from u to v, say v equals t minus u, so that v is zero at a free boundary point. You write your f and g, and okay, when you do these changes, what you're obtaining that you have that the fractional, you have essentially that the fractional Laplacian of my new variable v equals f times the characteristic function of the set D minus g the characteristic function of the complementary. Okay, and this is what I call what we call a two-phase unstable obstacle problem. Now you can forget for regularity. You can forget about this change of variables and just work with given any f and g that satisfies, just satisfy these relations here. So that's, I mean, you can do more general for regularity, for blow up limits. And so you know, f must be positive, g must be negative, but and the sum must be negative. So that's the two-phase unstable obstacle. Okay, so what did we do here? Now, if f and g are constants, then this problem was already considered in Allen, Lindgren, Petrosian. Now, if f and g are non-constants, then you have to work a little bit more, but you can do it. For instance, you have good energy estimates, integral gradient u squared is bounded. I mean, you have all the, if you work, then you get the compactness that you need. And for instance, say that you rescale VR, okay, here it's written with extension, but you rescale V by R power divided by R to the 2S. Remember that V was C2S. You have the C2S regularity, so this limit is well defined. You rescale the F and the G. And if you work a little bit, you get that the blow up limits to convert VR to be zero. Okay. So once that you understand that your blow-up limits behave well, then let's go to non-degeneracy. How do we prove that this blow-up limit is non-trivial? And that's the key point. As I told you, recall that U is C2S, and the following proposition is our key result. Is that if U and D is an optimal pair, and we take X0 to be a boundary point, then there exists a constant C independent of U such that the supremum of T minus U is greater or equal than CR to the 2S. Okay, this T comes from because at a boundary point, at a free boundary point, U takes the value of T. And okay, I have to say that this C is positive. Okay, so you get the bound from below and you have non-degeneracy. What's the proof of this? Okay. If you are away from the free boundary, then you can do a barrier argument. Just find a good comparison function and it works. But then you have to get to the free boundary. So you have to do an iteration getting closer and closer. In this iteration, you will get a summation of R to D2S in some sense. Okay, if S is greater than 1/2, this sum is not convergent. So that's why our non-degeneracy result only works for S less than 1/2. But anyway, this is the idea of the proof of non-degeneracy. You have to work, but the idea is it's clean. And what you get as a corollary is that if you have an optimal pair and V0 is any blow up coming from a rescaling, then your limit, this is positive, then your limit is non-trivial. And you will get a long contradiction and this will complete the argument. So I know that I have tried to sketch the proof. I hope it was not too fast. Now, let me go to some qualitative properties of the optimal configuration. And the first thing that we did is symmetry. So a proposition is that if sigma has symmetry and convexity with respect to a hyperplane, then any optimal pair has the same symmetry. Okay, this is expected, and the proof you will guess is just to use a Steiner symmetrization with respect to this hyperplane, and the equation behaves very well under symmetrization, and it works. So no, not very deep. Now, in particular, you get as a corollary uniqueness of optimal pairs when the domain sigma is a ball. Because so now we wonder: is the optimal pair unique? Well, the answer is that not in general. And maybe this is a more interesting result out of the symmetry breaking. That for an annulus sigma b, an annulus in R2. Let's say of radius b, between radius b and b plus 1, with large b greater or equal than 1, the optimal configuration D is not rotationally symmetric. So, and this is what happened in the local case, and it's also happening in the non-local case, and it's quite, it's striking. Okay, so what's the proof of this? Okay, if you have basically find a competitor in your minimization problem that has a lower infimum than the rotationally symmetric case, and the difficulty here, is how to build this competitor, is that I'm going to take a boundary function, so our competitor V of R theta in polar coordinates of the form H of R sinus N theta. Now this N is going to be chosen very big, and the main difficulty is that if this is your boundary data, how do you write the extension problem for the fractional Laplacian with this Dirichlet data? So now, once you do that, then you have to write the energy and calculate, and this is like pages and pages of calculation, try to handle those moles, because you know that when you work with a fractional Laplacian in radial coordinates, it's not an easy task. If you have radial functions, then to calculate the fractional Laplacian of a radial function is okay, but then you have to go to next modes. And that becomes technical. Okay, so I guess this is the end of the first part. And I see that I have a lot of time because maybe I ran too much, I apologize. So I'll have, we'll finish early. I'm going to talk about higher order generalizations of the Steklov eigenvalue. So recall that the Steklov eigenvalue corresponds to the Neumann data and it lives, in some sense, it lives on the boundary of the domain. What is the motivation to consider higher order generalizations? And in particular, I'm going to consider third order. Recall that the Steklov eigenvalue is first order. Now, what I'm going to do now is to talk about third order generalization that, for instance, comes very natural when you talk of, when you construct some dynamic boundary conditions for Kang-Hilliard equation. And people are working on that. I just learned about these works in a conference. So I was talking to, just by chance, and I thought it was a very nice relationship because I was looking at these problems from the conformal geometry point of view. So there is a very nice link. And now the conformal geometry comes, and I would like to maximize the first non-zero eigenvalue among metrics of fixed volume. It's a different problem from what I did before. This is just, this is a more geometric problem. Okay, so now let me give you a quick review on eigenvalues on a surface. So I take MG to be a surface of genus gamma, and let me give you the list of eigenvalues of the Laplace-Beltrami operator, lambda zero, lambda one, etc. Okay, I don't care that lambda zero is zero. I look at lambda one. So now we define lambda star of depending on the genus to be the supremum of lambda one times the area where G is any smooth metric on M. So I'm looking at all the possible metrics I can put on the surface and looking at the supremum, lambda one times the area. Now what we usually do is that, okay, we fix the area to be one and just maximize the Dirichlet eigenvalue. The first eigenvalue. And what can we say? This is a very old, it's very old works. It's very classical. For instance, for a maximizer, the eigenfunctions, just put them in a list. I use them as coordinates. And let me call U to be the map using the eigenfunctions as coordinates. For instance, they define a conformal map to SK. And if you consider the image by U of my original surface, let me call it S, then it gives you a minimal surface in SK. Okay, this is a way to produce minimal surfaces, but this is very classical. Let me get to the point, my point today. For instance, very old work of Hirsch, like for S2, as if you start with a unit sphere, the constant curvature metric is the new unique maximum of this eigenvalue. Okay, that's nice, it's a characterization. But what happens if you change your topology or your surface or whatever? Then let me recall the topological bounds of Zhang and Zhao that say that in general, the supremum lambda star gamma is bounded by a explicit constant in terms of the genus of the surface. Now this result is not sharp in general, and we would like to know if it is sharp or not, etc. Okay. So let me replace the eigenvalue of a surface by the Steklov eigenvalue. And here I'm quoting some classical results on Fraser Schwenn. Now, I take omega with a metric g, is going to be a two surface as before, but now it's going to have a bound that is sigma. And let lambda one to be the first Steklov eigenvalue for sigma, the same Steklov eigenvalue I use in my first part of the talk, except that now it's with respect to the geometry, using this metric g. And again, the same problem is that assuming that the volume of the boundary is one, well, in this case, it's not the volume, it's just a length, we would like to maximize lambda one with respect among all metrics with this boundary volume. Okay, so now I'm going to use the Steklov eigenfunctions as coordinates, as I did in the previous case, and let me say that let S to be the surface that comes, that is parametrized by using coordinates given by the Steklov eigenfunctions. Now, you can, as before, S is a minimal surface in the unit ball, but now, because you're using the Steklov, this is kind of a free boundary problem. It meets the boundary of V orthogonally. But anyway, let me go quickly because I don't want to get into this part. This is also related to half-harmonic maps, but let's just go quickly. What I would like to mention is that if you have a surface with a genus gamma with K boundary components, they prove that lambda one is bounded from above by this constant. That depends on the genus and the number of boundary components. And then you can ask, oh, is this sharp? Okay, if you take the simplest case, gamma equals one, case zero, this is just a Weinstock very classical result using complex analysis. But what happens if you change something else? Let's take an annulus where you can almost calculate explicitly in terms of spherical harmonics. Okay, when you do the calculation and it's a long calculation for the annulus, then you see that this calculation is not sharp. This bound is not sharp. This is one of the results in Fraser-Schwenn. And what is the difficulty in an annulus? Okay, you get an increase in sequence of eigenvalues, of course, but the Steklov eigenvalue, may not be the first one. You have to look at the first two eigenvalues, and there is a competition between the two of them, and there is some tricky things over there. So it's not, it's an easy calculation in some sense, but it's not obvious what you are going to get. Okay, so now let me sell a new object. Well, before I start with my third order object, let me tell you the fourth order case. So let M be a four manifold without boundary, and just to make things easy, let me put it in R5 if you want. And define the Punnett operator. The Punnett operator, it's a fourth order conformally covariant operator. And let me call it P, don't worry about conformal geometry if you don't want, just think that P in the flat case is the bi-Laplace, so fourth order. Okay, now that's scalar curvature Ricci, but no worry, just think that Punnett operator is a bi-Laplace. And let mu one to be the first non-zero eigenvalue of this operator on a four manifold. That is the following result by Chen and Li, where they give some geometric bounds for mu one. So imagine like fix your volume, don't worry about the denominator. You can find some, okay, some geometric quantities that that give you a bound for this mu one. And moreover, they show that equality holds if and only if M is a hypersphere in R5. Okay, But this the bounds are geometric. We would like to obtain some topological bounds as in the second order case. But this question is open in particular because four manifolds have a much more complicated topology than two surfaces. And we started looking at this, we started looking for references and we found that this problem was had not been considered in the literature. So that's open. And this is what I would like to sell you today. It's a third order boundary operator that was, let me say that the people who really made everything precise in conformal geometry was Jeffrey Case. So let me start with omega to be a subdomain in R4 with boundary, let me call it sigma. I'm keeping the same notation as in the rest of the talk. I define a fourth order energy corresponding to the Panitz operator. My energy is essentially the integral of the Laplace U square over my domain plus some other terms. I'll go over them in a moment, but think that this is the natural energy when you are going to consider a bi-Laplace equation. Now, why do I need to add these terms here? Because I have a boundary and I need to have a conformal property. So now H is mean curvature. When I put tilde, it means that I'm talking about boundary quantities. A little h means just the boundary metric. A is the second fundamental form, and again, tilde is boundary quantities. Okay, now I have a fourth order operator. I need to put two boundary conditions. I'm going to fix the first boundary condition to be normal derivative of u equals zero on the boundary. Now you can put more general things here, but to keep things easy, let's just put zero Neumann. Now, my third order boundary operator is going to be, I'm going to call it B3, is going to have Laplace of u. And eta is the normal derivative, so it's the normal derivative of Laplace of u. You see here the third order quantity. And then you have to add many lower order terms. Okay, your boundary has geometry. A0 is the traceless second fundamental form. H, I told you, mean curvature. But don't worry too much about the specific shape of these terms. It's just they really... what they do is that if you consider only this third order operator, this is not conformal when you make a conformal change, but when you add these terms, then it behaves very well. So I mentioned before that it was Jeffrey Case, the one who really wrote it, made things very systematic. But in for four manifolds, I think it goes back to works of Chang and Ching, and Okay, let me consider with these objects, let me consider the following eigenvalue problem. So let me take, let's just put the omega to be a domain in R4, so I don't have to worry about the geometry inside, put by Laplace u equals zero, with a normal derivative, Neumann, zero Neumann, on the boundary, and the eigenvalue problem, let's put it in B3 on the boundary. So B3 of u equals mu u on my boundary sigma. Oh, now my Rayleigh quotient did not come out in this transparency, but you have to minimize the energy times the integral of u squared on the boundary with some restriction, with the usual restrictions for the Rayleigh quotient, so that's not very important. Okay, and why is this eigenvalue, what would like to do with this eigenvalue? Okay, these are our results. As I said, this is work in progress with Marielle. We could do a few things that I'm going to go over, but there are still many, many open questions because we don't really know anything about this B3, but we feel that it's quite important, is the right object When you do geometry and topology of three manifolds. So that's the, I think this is the object that I think can be useful for classification, characterization, of three manifolds. Okay, again, assume that the volume of the boundary is one. And for instance, you can check that for the unit ball, you can have an increasing sequence of eigenvalues, you can write them explicitly, and well, that life is nice. But let's see what are our new results, and I'm not going to write them, but we did also the explicit calculation in the annulus. And I told you that this is quite tricky because the first two eigenvalues are competing with each other, but in any case, it's not very difficult, it's more technical, but this is something you have to do before you to check if your bounds are sharp or not. It's the first place to test. We also did the geometric bounds, very similar to the ones for the Punnett operator. And now the open question would it be that if we have topological bounds, but when we tried to do it for the fourth order case, there were we couldn't find anything, so it is also open for the third order case. Okay, yes, I have like 3 minutes left, but this is the end of my talk. I would like to thank you. Maybe there were some questions over the chat, but here is my for long questions. Here is my Skype login and my email. So please feel free to email if you have any questions. And again, I thank all of you for listening, and the organizers for arranging this wonderful thing.